This is The Perfect Rumor, a Jessie Hunt psychological suspense, book 19. Written by Blake Pierce, narrated by Debbie Soelter. Prologue. This was Tony Dante's least favorite part of the job. He didn't mind picking up the towel strewn on the locker room floor. He actually enjoyed replenishing the toiletries. There was something satisfying about seeing all those colorful bottles filled to the top. Even cleaning the toilets wasn't that bad if he got into the rhythm of it. But the steam room was something else. Of all his duties as an attendant in the men's lounge at the Spa Peninsula, maintaining it was the one he dreaded the most. Because management wouldn't let him cut off the steam during guest hours, there was no way to avoid getting sweaty if he was going to clean the area properly. Invariably, he'd have to take a shower afterward and change into a second uniform. That was why he always saved the task until near the start of his break. It was almost that time now. So, as his routine dictated, he got out of his work shoes and slipped on a pair of flip-flops. He hadn't seen anyone in the men's lounge for a while and considered stripping down to just his shorts, but then thought better of it. Someone could walk in at any moment, and if they saw the help shirtless, they might disapprove. So, he left the shirt on, grabbed two towels along with his disinfectant bottle, opened the door, and stepped into the thick mist. It was almost impossible to see. He started at the far right end of the room and began spraying and wiping down the white tile bench, careful to keep an eye out for anyone along the way. He hadn't seen anybody enter or leave the room in the last 15 minutes, so he was pretty sure it was empty. Staying that long in there was a Herculean undertaking, not to mention unhealthy. Still, as was his habit, he made a token effort to be sure.
"Anyone in here?"
he called out, his voice sounding strangely muffled by the vapor.
"Cleaning underway."
There was no response. He moved over to the longer middle bench and sprayed it down as well. As he was wiping the tile with his towel, he noticed a dark shape in the corner where the middle and left bench met. The fog was so thick that it was hard at first to even be sure that it was a person. But as he leaned in, he saw that it was a man, naked and slumped to the side, his head strangely suspended at an awkward angle.
"Sir, are you all right?"
Tony asked loudly, hoping the man had just fallen asleep and could be woken by a booming voice. The man didn't reply. It seemed to Tony that something was off, but he was reluctant to shake or even touch the man. He didn't want to get fired for inappropriate contact. Instead, he left the room and hit the button that turned off the steam while simultaneously sucking the moisture out. It took less than a minute to complete the process. Once that was done, he stepped back inside. What he saw made him drop the towels in the disinfectant bottle. Now that the steam had dissipated, he had a clear view of the man and he wasn't sleeping. Tony wanted to yell, but was too stunned to make any sound. The reason the man's head was at an awkward angle was because it was being held up by some kind of thick band or ribbon wrapped around his neck. The other end of the material was tied to a metal handlebar a few feet above and behind the tile bench. The man's eyes were wide open. He was dead. Tony could barely believe what he was seeing. He wanted to run, but his legs were locked up with fear and he stumbled backward, slipping on the slick tile floor. He landed hard on his butt, but shot back up and hurried out of the steam room into the sitting area, grabbed the courtesy phone, and called the spa's front desk. When the receptionist picked up, it took all his self-control not to scream into the phone.
"Call the cops,"
he said forcefully.
"There's a dead guy in the men's steam room."
Chapter 1. Jessie tried to ignore the pain. Instead, she focused all her energy on the end goal and not the struggle to get there. Though her thighs were burning and her breathing was heavy, she pressed ahead, her eyes fixed on her destination, her driveway. After another 30 seconds, she was there. She dropped out of sprint mode and slowed to a walk. She pulled out her phone and hit stop on the time clock of a running app. It read, 42 minutes, 29 seconds. Not bad for 5 miles. That's just under 8.5 minute miles. She allowed herself a moment of pride. She was still a long way away from getting back to the 8 minute mile she ran in college, but she'd already shown steady improvement in recent months. And considering all the injuries she'd suffered in the last few years, from stabbings to gunshot wounds, to multiple concussions and at least 2 strangling attempts, she thought she was doing pretty well. Jessie walked to the end of the block, allowing her breathing to return to normal. Her thoughts drifted to yesterday's seminar in criminal profiling at UCLA.
It was one of her final ones before rejoining LAPD's homicide special section full-time, and the vibe was bittersweet. Students, as they had for weeks, pleaded with her to reconsider. The post-lecture Q&A session ran longer than usual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.